So now we're going to go to the Sigmetrics Achievement Award talk lecture by Leandros Tassiulas. And to introduce Leandros will be a Professor Bruce Hayek. So please go ahead, Bruce.
Hello. Yes, I chaired the selection committee, and for this Achievement Award, we received several strong nominations. And several of them could have been worthy of this, but Leandro stood out, and we're very happy to present him with the Lifetime Achievement Award. Leandro is well known for his work in scheduling in a very broad sense, and it ranges from cross-layer allocation and wireless networks. His back pressure algorithm is very well known. He's also worked on scheduling multiple antennas for transmissions and joint power and beamforming papers. The methods based on Lyapunov function, quadratic Lyapunov function, are one of the rare things where it offers algorithms and also performance bounds at the same time. So without further delay, I'll introduce Leandros. He'll be giving a 30-minute talk, and then we have 5 to 10 minutes for Q&A. So Leandros, congratulations, and I look forward to your talk.
Thank you very much, Bruce. Thank you for the kind introduction, and your work has been very influential for me through the years. So it's very nice that it's you that introduced this. Hello, everybody. I was thrilled to receive the news that I received the Sigmetrics Award, and I'm really honored by the recognition from our research community. And I would like to thank the organizers for making this event happen, and Edmund in particular for looking every step of this online session we're experiencing. So I'll move to the talk. So this presentation is about the load balancing with and without adversaries, as I say here. And load balancing, of course, is an underlying theme in computer and networking with a very long history. Here, I will talk primarily for some issues that arise in scenarios with adversaries. So a lot of this presentation is contained in this paper here, but a lot of thoughts and methods are based on prior work, and I identify specifically these two that I mentioned, these earlier papers from 96 and 2006. So with this opportunity, I'll try to give a more broader view of load balancing and discuss the related works even beyond of beyond the specific focus on the talk. So the basic model that we'll see throughout the presentation is presented here. And in this model, we have a number of servers, N servers, and a number of streams of incoming job requests. So each job of stream K may be routed to a specific subset of servers that can be arbitrary and specific for each stream K. And the router, the dispatcher, needs to make the routing decisions. That is, which of the eligible servers each job of the stream will be directed to. The load balancing policy is the collection of these decision mechanisms for all the arriving streams. Now, the servers might receive jobs from multiple streams. So we have potential backlogs, and the backlog in each server, it's an important quantity as well to keep track through. And the objective of the load balancing policy is to optimize some metric, whether it is throughput, delay, loss, or a variety of metrics that may arise in different contexts. So we can recognize that this model can be encountered in several different settings, data centers or different networking scenarios. So we augment this model to capture possible denial of service attack scenarios by considering another collection of streams of fake jobs, the objective of which is to create a denial of service attack. So the adversary that deploys the attack, we assume that he has access to L streams of fake jobs that might correspond to different machines and botnets that may selectively have access to some machines of our network. So similarly, for each stream of fake jobs, there is a possibility to direct them to a subset of the system servers. So we have a mirror situation for the malicious traffic, as it is depicted here in the picture. And the decision or the attack policy that is deployed by the adversary is represented by the mechanism with which the fake jobs are routed to the servers. So the attack policy can similarly be represented by the collection of routing decisions of the adversary. We assume that both legitimate and malicious jobs are served at each server either in a FIFO fashion or by some scheduling discipline that is agnostic to whether a job is malicious or legitimate. We consider two broad classes of routing policies, both for the legitimate and the adversary and the malicious traffic. One class is the static policies, where the jobs that come from each specific stream K are split based on predetermined fixed proportions, RKN, to each one of the eligible servers. And of course, the total arriving traffic of the stream should reach one of the eligible servers. That is what is represented by this condition. Such a policy might be realized in many ways, might be a randomized rule or some other deterministic rule that determines the proportions irrespective of the state of the system. The other broad class of policies that we consider are dynamic policies, where the decision for the dispatching of each arriving job might be taken in a dynamic fashion at the arrival time based on information about the backlog state of the system, what is represented here. So the dynamic rules for each one of the arriving streams determine essentially the dynamic policies. Now, the objective, whether we have static or dynamic load balancing, is for the adversary to disrupt the service via a proper selection of the attack policy, while for the legitimate traffic is to ensure that despite the disruption attempts from the adversary, service is provided and the goal is accomplished. So we need to address this competition between the two sides. Now, I'll step back now and look first on the load balancing system without the adversaries to summarize a few important results in the past. And here is a general view of work that has been done on load balancing systems of the type we consider since the early 70s. So these systems have been considered with the objective initially to minimize the average delay via dynamic state-dependent control. So Markov decision process formulations had been considered, and the optimal dynamic allocation policy that minimizes the delay was characterized, that had usually the form of switching curves partitioning the state space of the system. When the system is symmetric, it has been identified that the well-known join the shortest queue policy is optimal, sorry, not optional. It's autocorrect here, problem. And the delay minimizing dynamic policy has been difficult to characterize in more complex topologies. So most of these results about delay optimality with switching curves types of control rules were for fairly simple systems as far as the topology is concerned or size. And another direction that has been pursued quite a bit was the objective of optimizing the system performance under static routing policies. So the general approach here was that the cost associated with each server N was a function of the aggregate traffic received by the server. And the objective was to minimize the total cost over all servers by a proper choice of the static routing policies. And again, a lot of work has been done on identifying optimal policies in different settings and assumptions about what information is available about the current cost or the current allocation of the load and so on. So in this approach, people were managing to optimize the network, but of course they were not taking advantage of the additional information of dynamic state information that if could have been taken properly into consideration, we might have even better performance than what is achievable by static policies. So a related work that we have been done early on, and it's reported in this 96 paper, somehow try to compromise these objectives of having optimal performance with optimal delay performance, let's say, with full state information and the objective of addressing large realistic systems. So in this work, we consider the following point of view. For certain, we considered first static routings, and we considered for specific system workload characterized by the traffic generation rates of the different streams, whether they are feasible in the sense that there is some static routing policy that ensures proper operation of the system and the finite delays. So this set of sustainable workloads represented by lambda is the legitimate operational region of the network. So a question we addressed is whether we can ensure such legitimate operation using dynamic policies and without having information about the statistics in the system or the network structure. So it turned out that a simple policy, the well-known join the shortest queue policy if it is adopted for its stream, it's good enough for ensuring proper stable operation in the general system. And in this case, the routing decision for each stream can be taken based on the backlog information of the eligible servers for the stream only. Furthermore, the necessary and sufficient conditions for the sustainability of workload were characterized. And they have the following simple form, that is, for any subset of the servers, it is enough if the aggregate capacity of the servers in the subset exceeds the traffic load of the streams that may only be routed within the servers of the set S. So these results are useful for the adversarial scenario that we'll see later. But before that, maybe I should mention the more general setting where this result hold and was shown in the previous paper. So it has been shown there that the JSQ policy, even in multi-hop networks, it is good enough for providing overall system stability and sustainable operation if it is enhanced by an additional feature of having each server performing flow control based on the back pressure rule that says that the server is active and provides service only if its backlog length is less than at least one of the eligible downstream servers. Otherwise, the server should idle. So the combination of this flow control rule with JSQ is adequate to provide the proper operation for these larger topologies. So JSQ policy appeared to be fairly powerful. For instance, in addition, it has been shown in that work that the JSQ provides sustainable operation even if the state information that is available for the dispatching of a job is delayed in a fairly arbitrary fashion, as it is indicated by the rule here. So that much about the JSQ in this general context. No, there is more actually, but this is in a different context, still relevant for the adversarial setting. And this other context is what is happening if the network operates in overload. Overload in the sense that the workload is not sustainable, or in other words, there is one or more subset of servers S for which the offered traffic to the subset exceeds the server, the subset capacity. And when I say offer traffic here, I mean offer traffic under any routing policy. So this is the traffic that is inevitably can only be routed to the servers of the set S. So if the workload of the network is in that regime, of course, sustainability is not possible. But still, JSQ routing has a very good performance in the sense that it ensures that the growth rate of the backlogs of the different servers is maximum optimal over any routing policy, which is the best that we can hope for in these overload situations. And this was a result that was included in this paper. Furthermore, a characterization of these growth rates was made in that work. And it has been shown that if we identify the set of servers for which the amount by which the offer traffic exceeds the service capacity divided by the size of the set is maximum, then it is known, it can be shown that the growth rate of the servers of the set S will be equal to R under the JSQ policy and being equal to this max min optimal vector. I should note here that networks in overload and in heavy traffic in general has been studied considerably the last several years until recently, and here are some representative works that show either approximate optimality of JSQ even in terms of workload optimization, as well as optimality with respect to higher order moments of the queue length process. So with the background of these results, let's go back to the adversarial setting that we saw earlier. And would like to address both the attack and the defense questions. Similarly to the routing policies that we described earlier for a legitimate workload, for the attacker, we may have either static attacks or dynamic attacks. So given a specific static attack for the attacker specified by the proportions QLN with which the malicious traffic is spread to the different servers under attack, a routing R for the legitimate traffic is feasible if this condition holds, like if we manage that eventually each server is not overloaded. Now we say that a workload is sustainable under some attack Q if there is a routing that is feasible under Q. So with this point of view, we may consider the region lambda sub Q to be the set of sustainable workloads under Q, that is the collection of all workloads for which there is a feasible routing when the attacker chooses the attack based on the vector Q. And we may consider the intersection of all the sustainable workloads over all possible attacks. And let's say that this intersection is the region lambda. Now, let's see what the properties of the workloads in lambda, what are the properties of the workloads in lambda. Note that for each workload in lambda, it is possible to find a routing scheme for which the system is sustainable no matter what the attack queue is. But of course, we may need to wisely select the routing of the workload given the attack. So in this sense, lambda can be called the region of sustainable workloads under the malicious attacker specified by the vector U1 through UL, where note that this vector represents the intensities of the attack war stream, the attack traffic streams. And let's say it's a basic restriction to whatever eventual attack queue we may end up deploying. Now, if we consider static routings, it is understandable that even if we have a sustainable workload, we need to select wisely the routing scheme in order to mitigate the specific attack queue that is chosen by the adversary. Now, it turns out, and that's not difficult to see actually based on the previous results, that if the adversary deploys static attacks, then JSQ routing from the side of the legitimate workload is adequate to provide sustainable operation, given that Q belongs to Lambda. Here is a simple example to illustrate the previous notions. So assume that we have a service system, as it is indicated here in the figure, that is three legitimate traffic streams with the same intensity A, four servers with nominal capacity one, and two attack streams with intensity B each. And the dashed lines indicate the eligible servers to which its traffic can be routed. We can easily see that in this setting, if there is no adversary, the region of sustainable workloads is this, that is, for any A less than 4/3, the system is sustainable. And if the adversary has malicious traffic with intensity D, the sustainable workload region Lambda is reduced to what is depicted here. So the depending on the intensity of the attack, A is bounded by one of those two terms. Okay. Of course, the attacker need not deploy static attacks, and the objective of the attacker is to bring down the system no matter what. So we may have dynamic policies on the side of the adversary, and a dynamic policy is allowed to make routing decisions based on current backlog information. And actually, will allow the attacker to be able to decide the routing information based on the different backlogs of legitimate and malicious traffic. So note that although that the servers cannot differentiate legitimate and malicious traffic, the attacker might be able to. And anyway, an attack policy that is based on the differentiated backlogs can only be more effective than one that doesn't. So if we design the system robust with respect to these policies, that can only help us. So we consider stationary dynamic attack policies where the routing decision of the fake jobs is based on some arbitrary function of this type. And one of the basic results that we found out is that if the legitimate workload is sustainable, then JSQ routing of the legitimate traffic can mitigate any stationary dynamic attack of the adversary and ensure stable operation as well as bounded delay for the legitimate traffic. The attacker, on the other hand, would like to maximize its effectiveness as well. So an interesting point of view to see is to see if the workload is not sustainable, whether the attacker, the adversary U, can always achieve its goal and bring down the system. So in order to address this question, we need to identify for each specific attack policy, what is the region of legitimate workloads for which the system is disrupted. So we considered a variety of attack policies, and We found out by extensive numerical study, actually, that a simple dynamic attack policy that ensures that the system is brought down and is disrupted as long as this is possible is if each one of the malicious traffic sources is routed based on the rule that is specified here in the formula, that is, each job is routed to the eligible server in DL for which the legitimate traffic load is maximum. Interestingly, actually, there is a paper in this conference by Fu and Modiano that construct a provably optimal attack policy. It's an interesting related result. Now, of course, the attacker can do whatever they want. So they don't need to be employ a stationary policy, that is, the rule that we have here or the rule that the attacker may employ it can be any, even time changing, right? And it turns out that the non-stationary attacks can be more effective if they are properly designed. Oops. That is, they may disrupt the operation and destabilize the system, even in cases where no stationary attack policy can achieve that goal. Actually, in the paper, we have a systematic construction of this kind of non-stationary attack policies, but here I will highlight the way they work by an example, as it is outlined here. So consider the following scenario, that is a single legitimate workload and a single attack workload served K servers. We see, of course, that if there is no adversary, any workload is sustainable as long as it is less than the total server capacity. Also, we can easily see that if we have a stationary adversary, the necessary and sufficient condition for a workload to be stable or to be sustainable is that A is less than K minus B. Now, if we allow or if we see this relationship from the other point of view, the adversary needs power B, which should be greater than K minus A in order to disrupt the operation. Now it can be shown that with a non-stationary approach, an adversary with attack power B that is greater than one can disrupt the operation of the system as well. And let me describe how that the policy will work. So in this non-stationary attack, where any B greater than one will be adequate to disrupt the operation of the system, so essentially cause unbounded delays, the attacker will direct all the attack traffic to the same server, and we'll do that in a cyclic fashion from server to server. Now the time intervals of the attack to each server in each cycle should be properly chosen. And furthermore, the length of the different cycles should be increased in a systematic fashion as well in order to achieve this disruption. So this is better described by a picture that is drawn here for a system with three servers. And we see how the attack policy will operate. So initially, all the attack traffic will be directed to server one that will build backlog for as long as we keep attacking the server. Then at some point, we'll direct all the traffic to server two. And at some point, server one and server two will have the same backlog. At that time, we switch the attack to server three. So at some point, all three servers will have the same backlog. At this time, we switch back to server one and we repeat the process for a period of time that is greater than the previous one by a multiplicative factor greater than one. Let's say we may double the cycle time in every period. That is good enough. So with this attack, we observe that the backlog evolution, we follow the curves we have here. And for each cycle, we observe that we have a period of time that all three servers are backlogged with a backlog that described by in this triangle. And we can make this triangle as large as we wish by increasing the cycle length, while we know that at each cycle, the proportion of time duration of this triangle remains the same. Note though that as the triangle increases, the delay of the traffic, either legitimate or attack traffic, increases as well. So by increasing the cycle, we may increase the average delay over the whole triangle as much as we wish, and we may disrupt the operation of the system. So I hope I gave you a flavor of the operation of the policy, and I'll conclude now. And a few observations based on this work. First, we note that we would like to note that there are several interesting open problems in the adversarial setting. For instance, characterization of metrics which are relevant to adversarial attacks is an important question, and more specifically, metrics that are relevant and to specific applications, that is, applications for which the application is sensitive for. And this is an interesting direction for further research, and the approach presented here might be of interest. A more general observation that comes out of the presentation, I hope, that is that as the technology evolves and the focus of attention of the performance community shifts, some basic load balancing principles continue to underlie system behavior and be important. Actually, I noticed in the title of the best paper award in this conference that load balancing was included as well. I don't know, maybe it's not related at all to what is presented here, but it's load balancing in general. And a last general statement that I hope reflects from what is presented is that basic research and addressing the important questions is a long-term investment in research. And with this, I'll finish.
Thank you, Leandros. We have time for a couple of questions. There's one written from Abhishek. You can look in the chat box, Leandros. He asks, do these results generalize when a job has to be sent to multiple servers for processing?
This load balancing model that is presented is very simple in the sense that each job engages just one server. I understand that a lot of scenario may arise, like what is mentioned by Abhishek, that is a job might need to engage several servers. The questions are certainly applicable in that setting. I can say that the earlier results about the load balancing, the join the shortest queue policy, generalize to these settings. If a job engages several servers, Other scheduling disciplines might need to be employed as well that are more reminiscent of max weight type of scheduling, since its server cannot be scheduled independently. So the maximum sustainability behavior without adversary, it's generalized. Now, if there are adversaries, I think it's an interesting open question for somebody to look at.
Okay, there's a question from Genoa Louis. For sustainable region under static attack, when B goes to zero, will the region go back to the original one without the attack?
Yeah, I mean, if B goes to zero, I mean, if there is no attack, we'll enjoy the same performance, yeah. And note that even with even if we allow non-stationary attacks, in order to have the effect I described, we need the attacker intensity to be high enough so that the attacker can bring down at least one server.
Okay, I have one question. So there's a Blackwell's approachability theorem, which is well known in game theory. And I'm wondering in an overload situation, if you could apply that to look at throughput regions that you could achieve in the overload situation.
The overload without adversaries?
With adversaries.
Well, that's possible. We haven't looked into it. So such a theorem might be useful to characterize the regions of the effective regions, both from the point of view of the legitimate traffic and the adversary. So that might be an interesting thing to look at.
Okay, thank you, Leandros. I think that's all the time we have. Thank you for a wonderful talk, and we'll move on to the next.
Thank you and everybody for attending.